Dear brothers, for the last few weeks, we've been talking about topics such as it is important to obey the order of Allah and to be Muslims, to submit ourselves to the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is exemplified in the Hajj, when we talked about Hajj. Hajj is basically when Allah Azza wa Jal made a covenant with us that أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ, am I not your Lord? And we said, yes, of course you are. And this entails that we obey Allah Azza wa Jal in this life. We are the slaves and the property of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this contract is a verbal contract, and the signature that we have to put down is the Hajj. Hajj is the signature to this contract. Then we talked about also, I think this was last week, to give the best of what we have to Allah Azza wa Jal. When we talked about the Udhiyah, and Ibrahim alayhi salam sacrificed, was willing to sacrifice his son Ismail, his most beloved thing that he had, to Allah Azza wa Jal. This means that we should give our best to Allah in our lives. When it comes to money, when it comes to time, when it comes to effort, we make Allah the first priority. And we offer the best gestures to Allah Azza wa Jal. And when we make dua, we even make dua with things that impress us that we like saying, oh Allah, I love you. Even this, because it means something to us. These words mean something to us. So giving that gesture to Allah Azza wa Jal. Today, inshallah, we're going to round off this topic of the closeness to Allah and the friendship with Allah with the topic, very important topic in this category, which is the dua. Dua. First of all, my dear brothers, did you know that the dua is actually a fard? It is fard on every Muslim to make dua. Not in a particular quantity, not at a particular length, not at particular intervals, but it is still fard. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He says in the Quran, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. Your Lord said, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ ادْعُونِي, call me, make dua to me. This is a command, an order in the Quran. So it's fard on us to make dua. And if anyone says that an order in the Quran is not wajib on me, that person is out of Islam. So saying that dua is not a fard, that I don't have to make dua, this person is then out of Islam. May Allah save us. So making dua is a fard. Allah said, make dua to me, أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ, I will answer you. Allah has given a guarantee that the person who calls him, he will answer him, Azza wa Jal. And then he said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي, whoever does not make dua, and the way Allah said this is whoever does takabbur, whoever has too much pride and arrogance from doing my ibadah, yani he does not make dua, سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ, they will enter Jahannam humiliated. So there's actually a punishment for not making dua. This ayah is very interesting for multiple reasons. Number one, it shows us that dua is fard. But also it shows us that Allah says, أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي, those people who are too arrogant to do my ibadah. Yani those people who are too arrogant to make dua. So if a person does not make dua, Allah is calling him arrogant. Why? Because the person who makes dua, he has ma'rifah of Allah. He knows Allah is listening. He knows who Allah is. He knows that Allah will listen. He knows the mercy of Allah, the rahmah of Allah. Not only that, but he knows that he has the tawheed. He knows that only Allah can answer my dua. Only Allah can answer my prayer. Only Allah has the power to give me what I need. Not only that, but he also has trust in Allah. That if I make dua, Allah will answer me. He has tawakkul in Allah. So the dua actually combines between all of these qualities of a true believer. The tawakkul, the ma'rifah of Allah, the reliance and the tawheed of Allah, it combines between all of these. So similarly, if a person does not make dua, it means he does not have the ma'rifah of Allah. He does not believe that Allah can, he does not believe or he does not act upon the belief that Allah will resolve his situations, that Allah will grant him what he needs. He relies on the asbab. Yes, we do the asbab as well, But if a person only relies on the asbab, it means he has forgotten Allah. He does not remember Allah. He does not trust Allah. He does not have the ma'rifah of Allah. He does not have the true tawheed of Allah. That's why Allah says, that's why he thinks he can do things. So that's why Allah says, those people who are too arrogant, who have takabbur, they are not the ones who make dua, they will enter Jahannam, humiliated. Allah save us. So making the dua, it combines between all of these qualities of a believer. That's another reason this ayah is so powerful. Another reason is because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Astajib lakum." Whoever does takabbur against my ibadah, whoever does not fulfill my ibadah, the ayah is about du'a. Whoever makes du'a, I will answer him. Make du'a to me. قال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي. So Allah is giving a command, make du'a, and then he's saying, whoever does not do my ibadah will enter Jahannam. So what's the match between du'a and ibadah? It shows us, the match is, that du'a is the main type of ibadah. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ actually said, الدُّعَاءُ مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ. Du'a is the core of ibadah. It's the root, it's the core of ibadah. A person who has other forms of ibadah, like zakat and siyam, those are the arkan. Of course he has to do them. But the core of it all, the culmination of it all, is the du'a, is raising the hands to Allah like a beggar and talking to Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is the important part, and this is the meaning behind, I'm talking about du'a today, but the meaning behind it is, the deeper thing I want to get across in today's talk is, talk to Allah. Have a conversation with Allah. Befriend Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah reaches out with a hand of friendship and walaya and love and mercy. Even though he is Rabbul Alameen, he is Ghaniyun Anil Alameen. He does not need any of us, he does not need anything. But he loves us so much that he reaches out with a hand of mercy and love and wanting to answer our dua. So we also should talk to Allah. Make Allah our wali, make Allah our khalil, and make Allah our habib. Even though, you know, some people, when they see people on the street talking, they think they are a crazy person. But be a crazy person for Allah. I don't mean you have to talk out loud, talk in your head. But be a crazy person for Allah Azza wa Jal. Talk to Allah Azza wa Jal. Tell Allah about your problems. Allah is listening. And as we'll mention, dua is not just about asking. We'll mention this a little bit later. But dua is not just about asking what our needs are, but it's also talking to Allah about what our problems are. Confiding in Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah already knows everything about us. But confiding in Allah Azza wa Jal, asking for help, exalting Allah, magnifying Allah, glorifying Allah, and thanking Him. Even a dua without asking anything. Just a dua where you express your love for Allah and you glorify Allah and magnify Allah. This is also a good dua. Dua is not limited to just asking. And my dear brothers, Allah Azza wa Jal shows us how important dua is. Not just in this ayah, and not just in this hadith that I mentioned, but everywhere in the Qur'an, Allah mentions the ad'iyah of all the anbiya. All the anbiya from Adam alayhi salam, Allah mentions their du'as. Showing us that du'a is so important, all the anbiya did it, and Allah accepted their du'a. It's such a common principle, or a common motif, you can say in the Qur'an, is the motif of du'a. In fact, the first du'a, chronologically, is the du'a of Adam. Actually, it's of Iblis, but I'm talking about in humankind. It's of Adam alayhi salam. And Adam alayhi salam, he asked Allah for forgiveness for what he did, but Allah was the one who taught him the words in the du'a. And Allah taught him the words, and he preserved them in the Qur'an, so that we can also recite them. قَالَ, they said, yani Adam and Hawa alayhim salam, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. O our Master, O our Lord, we have wronged ourselves. We have done dhulm against ourselves. But so you forgive us, and if you don't forgive us, and you don't have mercy on us, we will be lost. So the implication is, forgive us and have mercy on us. These words, Allah taught Adam. Adam did not come up with them himself. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتِ. So this is a dua of Adam. Now, even the next Rasul was Nuh. Not the next Nabi, but the next Rasul was Nuh. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions the dua of Nuh as well. We won't go through all the prophets, but Nuh made a dua for his son. Rabbi inna bni min ahli wa inna wa'daka al-haq wa anta ahkamul hakimin. He's seeing his son about to drown and he wants Allah to save his son. So he says, oh Allah, my son is from my family and your promise is true and you are the most wise. So what is he asking? Oh Allah, save my son. So Allah said, innahu amalun ghayru salih. Don't ask me about your son. Don't ask me from now on. Don't ask me because he is a bad deed through and through. Yani he is now among the people of Kufr. So don't ask me about him. When Allah said, don't ask me about him, then what did Nuh do? He made dua, oh Allah, save me from asking you that which is not appropriate. So he did not continue to make dua for his son. He did what Allah said. He made dua that Allah protect him from not asking about his son. There, we can make positive duas, like duas for things that are things that we need and glorifying Allah. There is also what in Urdu we call baddua. This is also a thing. And Nuh alayhi salam actually made this upon his ummah. He said, وَقَالْ نُوحُ رَبِّي لَا تَذَرْ عَلَى الْعَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ دَيَّارًا. Oh Allah, do not leave a single household of kufr alive, standing on this earth. So he's making, well, in Urdu you call a baddua, against his people. This is permissible for the person who has been oppressed. Generally we don't do this, but for the person who has been oppressed, there is no veil, there is no barrier between the oppressed person and his dua making it to Allah and being accepted. Otherwise, if a person is not being oppressed, if a person is not being wronged, his right is not being taken away, this type of dua against people, this is not usually not appropriate. This is not appropriate. In fact, Allah says, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء إلا من ظلم. Allah does not love the jahdi bisu except for the person who has been oppressed. And likewise, all the other anbiya, they made du'as, and the Qur'an is full of their du'as. In fact, when we think of Ibrahim, one of the things that comes to mind, at least for me, one of the things that comes to mind is all the du'as that he made in the Qur'an. With the word Ibrahim, automatically I think du'a. All the du'as that he made in the Qur'an. Sometimes for things of this dunya, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا. Oh Allah, make this a peaceful city, a safe city. And du'as for the akhirah and tawbah. رَبَّنَا أَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا. Oh Allah, after building the Kaaba, oh Allah, show us our rites and rituals and forgive us. So all of these du'as, the Qur'an is filled with the du'as of the anbiya, showing us that this is an important topic, that this is an important concept. This is how the anbiya were close to Allah Azza wa Jal. This is how they communicate. Obviously they had wahi, they had something we don't have, which is wahi. But they talk to Allah. They spread their hands out like a beggar and they talk to Allah. This is how we get close to Allah. Now I'm telling myself as well, I'm not just speaking as this is what you guys need to do. No, this is for me as well, because I'm not a waliullah or anything that I know how to get close to Allah and I'm telling you now all the secrets. No, I'm telling myself as well. Let us make dua and let us use this to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Let's befriend Allah Azza wa Jal. And we'll talk about, inshallah, the etiquettes of making dua near the end. Not only is the Qur'an filled with the du'as of the anbiya and the pious predecessors, but actually, remember that Surah Fatiha, the Fatiha, is a du'a. The Fatiha is a du'a for hidayah. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. The whole Fatiha, ulama say this, the whole thing is a du'a. We start with the praise and glorification of Allah, exalting Allah. We begin with the hamd of Allah. We glorify Allah, we magnify Allah. We admit our subservience to Allah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and then we make dua to Allah. It's a dua. إِهْدِنَا, guide us, O Allah. And the ulama say that, notice, that after the Fatiha, in the order of the Qur'an, is Surah Baqarah. In Surah Baqarah, the first few ayat are what? Alif Lam Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. That is a book in which there is no doubt, it is a guidance for mankind. Yani the ulama say that Fatiha is a dua for hidayah. The entire rest of the Quran is the jawab of that dua. So we make one dua, one or two or three ayat. Ihdina, O Allah, guide us. Allah spends over 6,000 ayat answering that dua. Allah is extremely generous. In Allah, Hayyun Kareem. My dear brothers, next, let us discuss what we make dua for. Like I said, one of the things that we make dua for, obviously, is our needs. And when we make dua for our needs, it's very important to remember that never forget the akhirah. Whenever you make dua, we can make dua for the dunya, for the things of the dunya. And the anbiya actually did that. Sulaiman alayhi salam, for example, says, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَهَبْ لِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّن بَعْدِي. O Allah, forgive me and grant me a kingdom in the dunya. Grant me a kingdom that it would not be appropriate, you would not give anybody after me. This is a huge dua for the dunya. It's permissible, totally, to ask for the dunya. And ask as much as you want of the dunya. But never forget, let us never forget the akhirah as well. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says about the Hujjaj, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. There are those among them who say, O Allah, grant us of the dunya. But they have no share in the akhirah. Why? Because they didn't ask for it. وَمِنْهُمْ, but among them, مَنْ يَقُولُ, are those who say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. O Allah, O our Master, grant us the goodness of the dunya, grant us the goodness of the akhirah, and protect us from the punishment of the hellfire, of the fire. These are the people who get of the dunya and the akhirah. So when we make dua for our needs, never forget the akhirah as well. And the Prophet ﷺ said that when you ask Allah, ask for firdaus, because it is the highest, the a'la al-jannah, a'la al-jinan. When we ask Allah, the second point, when we ask Allah for something, ask even for the smallest things. Aisha radiallahu anha said that when you want to get a new shoelace, ask Allah for a shoelace. Look, yani a shoelace. Why? She says because if that shoelace was meant for you, it's not gonna miss you. Allah is not gonna, it's not gonna miss you. But if it was not meant for you, you'll never get it. So make dua. Yani, not only that, what Aisha said, definitely true. What I also want to get the message across is, ask Allah for the littlest things. Allah, I need a haircut. Allah, I need new shoelaces. Allah, I want a new pair of clothes. Why? Because this gets us close to Allah. We get used to talking to Allah. We get used to asking Allah. Let us not think just because something is easy for us to get, that Allah cannot prevent it from us. And just because something is difficult to get, then only then we ask Allah. No. Everything comes from Allah, big and small. So let us get used to asking Allah, having a conversation with Allah, having our conversation with Al-Wali, that He grant us. So ask Allah first. That doesn't mean don't do the asbab. Go out and buy it too, obviously. But ask Allah to create that bond between the Rabb and the makhluk. So not only ask Allah for the small things, but also ask Allah for the large things. Do not be afraid to ask Allah for the largest things that you can think of. As long as they are halal, of course. As long as the dua is halal, ask everything. We just mentioned that Sulaiman alayhi salam asked for a kingdom that no one would have after him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that, ask Allah the biggest things, everything. The Sahaba said, kind of in a worried way, I guess. They said, then we'll ask Allah for such huge things. Prophet ﷺ said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. You think that your dua, what you're asking for, is going to bankrupt Allah? وَلَعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in a hadith Qudsi, عِبَادِي, يَا عِبَادِي, لَوْ أَنَّ أَوَّلَكُمْ وَآخِرَكُمْ وَإِنسَكُمْ وَجِنَّكُمْ قَامُوا فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ فَسَأَلُونِي فَأَعْطَيْتُ كُلَّ إِنسَانٍ مَسْأَلَتَهُ فَلَا يَنْقُصُ فَمَا يَنْقُصُ ذَلِكَ مِمَّا عِنْدِي إِلَّا كَمَا يَنْقُصُ الْمِخْيَطُ إِذَا أُدْخِلَ الْبَحْرُ. O my servants, if the first of you and the last of you, meaning from Adam to Jahannam, every insan, and all the insan and all the jinn, and the jinn are roughly, ulama estimate, 10 times as many as the number of insan. So if all of you, ins and jinn, man and woman, child and old, young, everyone, asks Allah for everything that He needs from A to Z, and Allah says, if I were to grant all of that to you, that would not reduce from my treasures, from what I have, except when you dip a needle into the ocean, then the amount of water it takes out of the ocean. And ulama said, like for example, Shaykh Yasir al-Qadi, he said, don't take that literally. Because when you dip a needle into the ocean, it does take some molecules of H2O, doesn't it? But Allah's treasures are unlimited. Even that much is not taken out from Allah's treasures. So be careful about even taking that literally. But it's just to give us an idea. Allah's treasures are unlimited. Ask Allah everything. Don't be afraid. Ask Allah for the dunya. You want a house? Ask Allah for a house. You want money? Ask Allah for money. No problem. There is nothing preventing us from that. My dear brothers, so let us, when we ask Allah, then ask Allah of the smallest things, the biggest things, and don't forget the akhirah. Those are the three points. There are also du'as that we make that are not asking Allah necessarily for anything. They're simply glorifying Allah. They're doing the hamd and the tasbih, the tahmeed and the takbir of Allah Azza wa Jal. Just remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. And many of the masnoon du'as are like this. By the way, we should make du'a in our own language in a way that affects us. But there are du'as that are masnoon, that are from the Prophet ﷺ. They have to be said in Arabic exactly as they have been said. And there's a hadith that proves this anyways. They have to be said exactly that way in Arabic, but you have to know their meaning. At least at a high level, you have to know basically what it means. Because if you don't know what the du'a means, then it's not a du'a. It's a magic spell, right? So it's not a du'a if you don't know what it means. So we should learn the meaning, but at every marhala in our life, there's a du'a. Getting up in the morning, there's a du'a. Entering the washroom, there's a du'a. Looking in the mirror, there's a du'a. Starting the wudu, there's a du'a. In the middle of wudu, there's a du'a. At the end of wudu, there's a du'a. Leaving the washroom, there's a du'a. Looking again in the mirror, there's a du'a. At the end of salat, there's a du'a. Beginning eating, there's a du'a. During eating, there's a du'a. After eating, there's a du'a. Leaving your house, there's a du'a. Every single step of the way, there's a du'a. Why? So we remember Allah constantly throughout our day. So we never forget Allah. And all of these du'as, most of them, we're not necessarily asking for anything. Some of them we are. But most of them, we are simply praising Allah Azza wa Jal. We are glorifying Allah Azza wa Jal. We are thanking Him for the thing that we have just enjoyed. Like our when we eat, and or when we have finished eating, we are thanking Allah. When we leave the washroom, we are thanking Allah for having taken the dirt out of us and granting us the ability to do that. Because if that was not possible, then we'd be in big trouble. So we are thanking Allah. So not every du'a is necessarily asking for something. The du'a is also just praising Allah Azza wa Jal. The example is that of Yusuf alayhi salam. Yes. رَبِّي قَدْ آتَيْتَنِي مِنَ الْمُلْكِ وَعَلَّمْتَنِي مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ فاطر السماوات والأرض أنت وليي في الدنيا والآخرة توفني مسلما وألحقني بالصالحين. So Yusuf alayhi salam, he is saying, oh Allah, you have given me so much. You have taught me how to interpret dreams. You have given me all of this. You have protected me. You are my wali in this dunya and in the akhirah. And at the end, yes, he does make a dua. He says, give me death as a Muslim. Now this is the dua that he asked for. But you see that most of the du'a, he is praising Allah Azza wa Jal. He's thanking Allah Azza wa Jal. So that is also a type of du'a. Imam Shafi, for example, when someone came to him and he was wanted to see what kind of a du'a is he making, he stood there and he saw Imam Shafi, he's making a long du'a, big nazm, long poem. But he didn't ask Allah for anything. He was just glorifying and praising Allah. So he was wondering, what kind of du'a is this? This was amazing. And my dear brothers, for example, Abdullah ibn Umar, when he was making tawaf during the Hajj, the Khalifa of the time, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, he came also to make Hajj, and he came with his bodyguards and so on into the Haram, and he saw Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, and he had a lot of reverence for these Sahaba, you know? So he wanted to just honor this Sahabi that he was seeing, and he wanted to give him. So he came up to Abdullah ibn Umar, and he said, oh Abdullah, ask me for anything, I will give it to you. And he's the Khalifa. He owns he's the king of the, from all the way from Asfahan all the way to the west, you know, the North Africa. He owns all this land. He's the Khalifa of the believers at the height of the kingdom. So he said, just ask me for anything, I will give it to you. And Abdullah ibn Umar said, I do not like that when I am in his house that I ask a makhluk for anything. So he said, okay, I'll wait outside. So he finished his tawaf, the Khalifa Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, he finished his tawaf and he went with his bodyguards outside and he waited at the exit for Abdullah ibn Umar to finish his tawaf. And he made a long tawaf. And the Khalifa was outside, he was sitting in the sun, you know, just waiting for Abdullah ibn Umar. So he made long tawaf, he made long salat behind Maqam Ibrahim, and finally he came out. So the Khalifa intercepted him. And he said, now that you are outside of his house, now I say to you, ask me and I will give it to you. He said, ask you of the dunya or the akhirah? He said, obviously the dunya, not the akhirah. What do I have control over the akhirah? So he said, by Allah, I did not ask it from the one who owns it. How am I going to ask it from you? He basically just wasted his time. So, yani, the point is that the shahid here is that even he is making these long, this long tawaf and this long salat and long dua, and he didn't ask Allah for anything. He didn't ask Allah for anything, not, at least not of the dunya. You know, he's just praising Allah. So my dear brothers, this is another type of dua where we just praise Allah. And yes, it is permissible and possible to also complain to Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is another type of dua, to complain. But not complain as in, oh Allah, why are you doing this? Oh Allah, why is this happening to me? That's not complaint. Complaint is, oh Allah, I feel lonely. Ya Allah, I feel tired, I feel exhausted. Ya Allah, I feel that something needs to change. Ya Allah, should I get a new job? What should happen? What should I do? Ya Allah, I feel tired in this job. Ya Allah, I feel tired with this, you know, whatever the case may be. So expressing those deep complaints and those deep thoughts to Allah Azza wa Jal, not in a way that we complain to Allah necessarily, but in a way that we express our problems to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is proven from Yaqub alayhi salam. Yaqub alayhi salam says, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُوا بَدِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. I'm only complaining about my grief and my sorrow to Allah Azza wa Jal. We only have a few minutes left. In that time, I wanted to talk about some of the etiquettes of dua. But let me not, we don't have enough time to go through all the etiquettes, but let me just mention one etiquette, which in my humble opinion is the main etiquette of dua, which is this. Yes, we must balance between two things. Number one, make dua to Allah, be friends with Allah. Allah is our wali, our friend. You know, make dua to Allah. And as I said, I think it was last week, don't make dua like this. You don't make dua with the back of your hand. Prophet ﷺ said, don't show Allah the back of your hand when you're making dua. Put your hands down like this, like a beggar. Right? Make dua with the palms of your hands, like this. Not like this. So many people do this. So do this. Right? So be a beggar in front of Allah. Ask Allah. So balance between the friendship with Allah and the love with Allah with respect. Because this is Rabbul Alameen we're dealing with. This is the master of the universe we're dealing with. This is Allah Jalla Jalalu wa Amma Nawalu. This is the master of the universe, who between him and his makhluk are 70,000 curtains, the hujub of Allah. And if this hujub were to be removed from Allah, احترقت احرقت سبحات وجهه كلما مضى عليه بصر. So everything that Allah sees, which is everything, if this curtain was removed, if this curtain was removed, everything that Allah sees, yani everything would be burnt to a crisp immediately. This is Allah Azza wa Jalla we're dealing with. Not just our boss, who we might disrespect. Not just a king, who it's possible and permissible and, you know, in certain circumstances you might disrespect. You know, no, this is Allah Azza wa Jalla, master of the universe. We must maintain a level of respect and dignity, and be careful with how we speak with Allah Azza wa Jal. So let us be very, very mindful of this. But at the same time, Allah is also our wali, our friend. So confide in Allah, talk to Allah, ask Allah of the smallest things and the largest things. And in my humble opinion, this is the most important etiquette to remember. Don't go too far to the friendship side that we lose respect, and don't go too far to the respect side that we, not too far to the respect side, I mean, like, do not lose sight of the fact that Allah is our friend. Allah is the friend of the believers. And the very last thing I'd like to mention, I will finish with this, is that do not make dua to Allah. Let us not make dua and then just sit back and expect Allah to answer the dua just like that. He may, but there, what does it mean for Allah to accept the dua? Allah might accept the exact dua that we make. Allah might see that it is not the best thing for us, so He gives us something different and better. Allah Azza wa Jalla, instead of giving us what He wants, He might avert from us a calamity. Or He might just give us reward, if nothing else, for making the dua. He might just give us reward. And the Prophet ﷺ said that if you come on the Day of Judgment and you see your du'as that were not answered and the amount of reward that you get for them, you will wish that none of your du'as were answered. So, make du'a to Allah and do not lose hope in the answer from Allah. Umar radiallahu anhu said that I just worry about making the du'a. Allah worries about the response. I worry just about making the du'a, not the response. Keep asking Allah Azza wa Jal. Keep begging Allah Azza wa Jal. Do not lose hope in Allah Azza wa Jal. Do not, let us not act on our own timescale. Let us leave that to Allah Azza wa Jal. Just keep asking. If it's not being answered, if you do not see the answer, just keep asking. Allah will answer. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Inna Allaha Hayyun Kareem." Allah is, I'm going to use the word merciful. I do not know how to translate Hayy in a way that is appropriate to Allah. Hayy means shy, but I do not want to use that word for Allah Azza wa Jal. So if you want to take the word shy, just make sure that you know we're careful with that word. But I'm going to use the word merciful. Allah is too merciful. Kareem, Allah is too generous. يَسْتَحْيِي إِذَا رَفَعَ الْعَبْدُ يَدَيْهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّهُمَا صِفْرًا حَتَّى يَضَعَ فِيهِمَا خَيْرًا. Allah is too generous, too merciful. He's so merciful, he's too merciful that when the abd raises his hands to Allah, that Allah leave those hands without putting some good in them. Allah will give you something. Wallahi. Allah says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Allah promised, and wallahi, Allah is not a liar. It doesn't matter how long it takes. Do not lose hope. Allah will give you.
Inshallah.
As-salamu alaykum.